Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Social and Cultural Anthropology, a very short introduction by John Monaghan and Peter Just, narrated by Eric Jason Martin.
A very short introduction. For over 20 years, we have been talking about what anthropology is, how to do it, and how best to communicate what we know. This dialogue began when we were graduate students at the University of Pennsylvania, learning to be anthropologists. We continued to exchange ideas after we went off to do fieldwork, an exercise at the core of our discipline and something we will have a lot to say about in the first chapter. But what enhanced our conversation more than anything was our experience of becoming teachers. The task of introducing anthropology to thousands of educated non-specialists over the years has convinced us that the best way to do this is to emphasize not so much what anthropologists have discovered, but how anthropologists think about what they have learned, concepts over facts, if you will. This means we will not be as concerned with reviewing the latest trends as with trying to look at the issues that have been at the heart of anthropological inquiry and with trying to convey what has been of enduring value in our discipline. Anthropology grew out of the intersection of European discovery, colonialism, and natural science. In the 19th century, the first anthropologists, influenced by the same philosophical currents that led to the Darwinian Revolution, were interested in reconstructing stages of social and cultural evolution. Figures such as Edward Tyler and Lewis Henry Morgan published influential works tracing everything from writing systems to marriage practices, from their most primitive origins to their modern manifestations. By the beginning of the last century, anthropologists had developed other intellectual projects, and most importantly, were no longer content to rely on the accounts of colonial officials, missionaries, travelers, and other non-specialists for their primary data. They began to go into the field as ethnographers to gather their own information firsthand. Although anthropology has changed quite a bit since the time of these ethnographic pioneers, ethnography remains one of the things that distinguishes anthropology from the rest of the social sciences. And the importance of doing ethnography is perhaps the one thing that all anthropologists agree upon. In the early part of the 20th century, anthropology was typically concerned with small-scale, technologically simple societies. In part, this was out of a desire to record ways of life that were rapidly changing with the advent of colonialism, although it would be a mistake to assume that these societies were somehow unchanging, or even truly isolated, before their contact with the West. And in part, it was out of a desire to get at the essential or elementary forms of human institutions, although it would also be a mistake to assume that matters such as law or religion are somehow more basic in these societies. In the latter part of the 20th century, mainstream anthropology has moved away from a vision of itself as a science in the tradition of the physical sciences and has adopted a more interpretive, humanistic approach. It has also shifted its focus from an exclusive concern with non-Western, small-scale, rural societies to groups that would have been the purview of sociology, such as labor unions, social clubs, and migrant communities found in urban and industrialized settings. Nonetheless, anthropology remains broadly comparative in its scope, taking all societies into account and treating them all as equally significant. At the same time, anthropology continues to be firmly rooted in the descriptive richness that comes out of the specific encounters anthropologists have with particular peoples and places. Often, we have found our greatest strengths to be those of the storyteller. Throughout this book, we will be illustrating our presentation with anecdotes from our fieldwork. This, by the way, is quite typical for anthropologists, for whom the immediacy of the encounter with an exotic culture never really fades. So let us tell you a bit about the two societies with which we are the most familiar. Peter did his primary research among the Dao Dongo for 2 years in the early 1980s, with several subsequent shorter visits. At the time, the Dao Dongo numbered around 20,000 people, living in the highland massif that sweeps up on the west side of Bima Bay, a spectacular natural harbor in the eastern end of the island of Sumbawa. Sumbawa lies about midway in the long arc of islands stretching from Sumatra to Timor in Indonesia. It is the second major island east of Bali. The eastern half of Sumbawa is called Bima, although that is not the local name, and is mostly occupied by a much larger ethnic group who call themselves Dao Mabojo and are usually referred to as the Bimanese by outsiders. As part of the ancient Javanese Majapahit Empire, Bima was a Hindu kingdom. When that empire collapsed in the early 17th century, Bima and her people became Muslim and today are known as among the most fervent Muslims in Indonesia, a country where perhaps 85% of the population confess that faith. The Dao Dongo, however, had remained outside the Bimanese kingdom while it was a Hindu kingdom, and became part of the Muslim Sultanate of Bima only much later, and by treaty rather than by conquest. They were able to retain their relative independence in part because they had a reputation as fierce warriors, and in part because their mountainous territory was relatively easy to defend. Dao Dongo means mountain people. Although they became part of Muslim Bima, the Dao Dongo retained certain political privileges and did not, by and large, accept Islam, but held fast to their indigenous religious beliefs and practices. It was their stalwart refusal to accept the religion of their suzerain and neighbors that first interested Peter in the Dao Dongo. He set out to see what role this might have played in establishing an ethnic boundary between the Dao Dongo and the Bimanese, despite the fact that they share a common language, Ngahi Mabojo. By the time of Peter's first survey trip to Dongo, as the district is most sensibly called, most Dao Dongo had accepted either Islam or Christianity, although, as the local Roman Catholic catechist put it, the people are 70% Muslim, 30% Catholic, and 90% Kafir, pagan. Studying religious beliefs became a major focus of Peter's fieldwork, as did studying the way the people went about resolving disputes. When Peter returned to Dongo in 1981 for a 2-year stay, he was accompanied by his wife, Anne, who was, to put it mildly, a real trooper. They lived in the village of Doro Natika, the oldest and, with a population of about 3,000 spread over several hamlets, the largest of Dongo's traditional villages. Conditions were quite primitive. Doro Natika had no running water, no electricity, no paved roads. The houses, on the other hand, were comfortable, built of teak and resting on stilts 1.5 meters high or more, with roofs of thatch, tile, or galvanized iron. The local economy was in something of a transitional period. Formerly, the people had had a relatively self-sufficient subsistence by means of the cultivation of swidden rice, maize, and millet, supplemented with bananas, coconuts, and other fruits, together with products gathered from the mountain forest, including the most wonderful honey. Swidden agriculture depends on burning tracts of forest, cultivating the land for a year or two, and then allowing the forest to regenerate. Increasing population densities, however, had put too much stress on the land to allow for complete forest regeneration, and much of the land was taken over by growths of weedy shrubs, much reducing its fertility. Increasingly, the people of Doro Natika were shifting to the cultivation of wet rice in terraced paddy fields and the cultivation of cash crops such as peanuts and soybeans for sale in lowland markets. Although the population was growing rapidly because of the introduction of modern medicine, diseases such as malaria, tuberculosis, and dysentery still took a heavy toll, especially among the infants and children of the village. Despite the difficulties of life in these circumstances, Peter and Anne found the Dao Dongo to be warm, generous, and ever ready to tease and joke. With the help of a rather roguish village headman, Peter and Anne were able to borrow a house which they furnished with goods available in Bima Town, including a kerosene stove that created a minor sensation, as everyone else in the village cooked over wood fires. Doro Natika is built on a high ridge between river gorges. The houses are built on terraces cut into the steep sides of the ridge. In time, Peter and Anne acquired 2 ponies which they used for transportation and to carry water up from the river. From time to time, they would go down to Bima Town to collect their mail and replenish food supplies not available in Dongo. While there, they stayed with the family of Haji M. Jafar Amin, who were exceptionally generous hosts, so Peter and Anne were able to get an intimate look at life also among the lowland Bimanese. With the exception of several vacations to Bali and other parts of Indonesia, Peter and Anne lived there for 2 years. It was an unforgettable experience. John did his primary field research among the Mixtec of Santiago Nuyo in the southern Mexican state of Oaxaca. His longest period of fieldwork lasted from 1983 to 1986, but he has returned almost every year since. Mixtec speakers, who number just over 400,000, are the third largest indigenous group in Mexico. In the 16th century, the Mixtec were divided into dozens of small kingdoms whose ruling elite patronized one of the finest artistic traditions in the New World. We know a great deal about pre-conquest Mixtec life from the large corpus of Mixtec books that survived, and because Mixtec scribes continued to produce works using the native script for almost 80 years after the Spanish took over. After their conquest by the Spanish, the Mixtec suffered a catastrophic demographic collapse as millions of people throughout the Americas succumbed to old world diseases and the abuse they suffered at the hands of colonialists. Although the Mixtec population has grown since the end of the 16th century, it is still not the size it was before the arrival of the Spanish. The Mixteca, the homeland Mixtec speakers share with several other indigenous groups, as well as communities of mestizos and Afro-Mexicans, is ecologically diverse, having a broad coastal savanna, tropical forests, high pine-forested mountains, fertile riverbeds, and arid deserts. The Mixtec live scattered across the landscape in small towns and villages. Santiago Nuyo, the village where John has done most of his field work, has a population of about 3,000 people, with about a quarter of its inhabitants living in the town center and the rest distributed among 5 hamlets. Nuyo and its neighbor Santa Maria Yucuhiti sit at the head of a narrow canyon, with beautiful waterfalls flowing down the canyon sides. The landscape is extremely rocky, and there are almost no level plots. Nuyotecos will often say goodbye to one another by calling out, "Don't fall." But owing to its relatively low elevation and abundant rainfall, the area is known as the Garden of the Mixteca. Oranges, mangoes, and zapote grow wild, rare orchids cling to the trees, and a pine forest covers the surrounding mountains. Nuyotecos specialize in the cultivation of maize, almost all of it grown through Swidden techniques. They also grow cash crops, principally bananas and coffee. Although wage migration has been a fact of life for the Mixtec for hundreds of years, since the 1950s, increasing numbers of Nuyotecos have left the Mixteca. At first, they traveled to Veracruz and Morelos to find work harvesting coffee and other crops. Then in the 1960s, they began to travel to Mexico City, where they worked in bakeries, factories, and in the service economy. And finally, in the late 1980s, a few men made their way to the United States, where they worked on a ranch in Texas. John's research focused on how Nuyotecos maintain a strong sense of community in the face of these changes and dislocations. Although John's wife, the archaeologist Laura Junker, did not live with him during his initial period of fieldwork, She was pursuing her PhD in anthropology. She did spend several months in Nuyo. Later, after their children were born, the whole family came to the Mixteca to visit. Like the Dodongo, the Mixtec enjoy a good joke, and despite the numerous photographic essays of indigenous Mexican people that portray everyone with grim, determined, or overwhelmed looks on their faces, when they are among themselves, Nuyotecos turn out to be great pranksters and masters of understatement. John realized he had finally got the measure of them after meeting a group of men on a path outside town. They asked him what kind of food he and his wife were going to serve at an upcoming fiesta they were hosting. John and Laura were able to afford to serve choice cuts of meat, but they were, at the same time, outsiders with strange tastes. John managed to deliver his reply, "We are going to slaughter a couple of thin and mangy dogs," with so little change of expression that the men all paused before going off hooting with laughter. John owes much of what he knows about the Mixtec to the Perez Sarabia, Perez Perez, and Modesto Velasco families, who took him in, allowed him to live with them, and by asking him to be the godfather of one of their children, made him a relative. No short introduction, much less a very short introduction, could hope to do justice to the breadth and complexity of contemporary anthropological studies. At the end of the 20th century, the Royal Anthropological Institute had over 2,300 members. The American Anthropological Association had over 11,000 members. France, too, was the home of a rich and deeply influential school of anthropology. Most exciting, perhaps, has been the growth of anthropology in Latin America and in former European colonies, prominently India and New Guinea. Each of these nations, along with industrial nations such as Australia and Japan, has begun to develop its own intellectual traditions and research agendas. Obviously, we could not provide you with a survey of anthropology that would begin to cover all the perspectives and projects these anthropologists engage. Instead, we have tried to focus our very short introduction on those big questions that have occupied the attentions of anthropologists since the beginnings of the discipline. What is unique about human beings? How are groups of people, family, class, tribe, nation, formed? And what holds them together? What is the nature of belief, economic exchange, the self? How are we to go about researching and understanding such things? And rather than try to provide you with a sense of what the cutting edge of anthropological theory is today, a picture sure to become obsolete as soon as it is published, we have chosen to acquaint you with the ideas at the roots of the discipline, and with the thinkers whom all anthropologists share as intellectual forebears. In the first chapter, we introduce you to anthropology by trying to give you an idea of what it is that anthropologists do. In the next two chapters, we look at culture, traditionally an American preoccupation, and society, traditionally a British one, the twin conceptual towers on which anthropology is founded. In the next two chapters, we look at the most basic ways in which human beings form social ties, first through ties of blood and marriage, and then through larger social groups such as tribe, ethnic group, and nation. In the final three chapters, we look briefly at issues of economy, religion, and identity, topics that have attracted anthropologists for generations, and in which, we feel, some of the most interesting classic work has been done. We have necessarily left out many fascinating subdisciplines: medical anthropology, the anthropology of law, the anthropology of science and technology, to name but a few. Any of these could easily be the topic of its own very short introduction, and in this regard we can only urge you to take this book as the narrow opening of a very wide door, and hope that it will inspire you to explore much further. Chapter 1. A Dispute in Dongo. Fieldwork and Ethnography. As has often been said, If you want to understand what anthropology is, look at what anthropologists do. Above all else, what anthropologists do is ethnography. Ethnography is to the cultural or social anthropologist what lab research is to the biologist, what archival research is to the historian, or what survey research is to the sociologist. Often called, not altogether accurately, participant observation, ethnography is based on the apparently simple idea that in order to understand what people are up to, it is best to observe them by interacting with them intimately and over an extended period. That is why anthropologists have tended traditionally to spend long periods, sometimes years at a stretch, living in the communities they study, sharing the lives of the people to as great an extent as they can. It is this approach that has defined our discipline and distinguished it from other social sciences. Now, we certainly do not dismiss the methods more characteristic of other disciplines, such as the use of questionnaires or the collection of quantitative behavioral data. But anthropologists have long felt that approaching the study of human beings in those ways is likely to produce an incomplete, even misleading, understanding of the people studied, especially when those people are members of foreign or unfamiliar societies. It might also be said that fieldwork is what gives the enterprise of anthropology a good deal of its romance. It was certainly one of the things that attracted the two of us to the discipline. Today, anthropologists conduct fieldwork in settings that are as unexotic as television stations in city centers, magistrates' courts in small towns, corporate boardrooms, and church congregations in middle-class suburbs. But in its infancy as a profession, anthropology was distinguished by its concentration on so-called primitive societies, relatively small, non-Western communities in which social institutions appeared to be fairly limited and simple, not so as it turned out, and social interaction was conducted almost entirely face-to-face. Such societies, it was felt, provided anthropologists with a simplified view of the elementary workings of society, one that contrasted with the complexities of modern, that is, Western, society. There was also a sense among anthropologists that the ways of life represented by these smaller societies were rapidly disappearing, and since many of them had no writing, it was an urgent task to preserve a record for posterity. This orientation of the discipline, and an early commitment to the first-hand collection of ethnographic data by means of participant observation, led anthropologists to some of the most remote and exotic places on Earth. Most often working alone and in isolation from other Westerners, the ethnographer cut a bold figure indeed. Often this isolation created a sense of alienation and loneliness, especially in the early stages of fieldwork. But almost all anthropologists find themselves assimilating to the culture of their host communities to a greater or lesser degree, a few, it is said, even to the point of going native, completely adopting the lifestyle of their hosts and never returning home. Altogether, the process of immersing oneself in fieldwork can be a challenging and unique experience, one that continues to attract men and women to anthropology. It also so happens that participant observation seems to be the most effective way of understanding in depth the ways in which other people see the world and interact with it, and often provides a check on our own preconceptions and beliefs. Let us begin with a story that shows you not only how anthropologists work, but what is distinctive about anthropology as a discipline. This is a story about Peter's fieldwork with the Dao Dongo and how he came to be interested in the anthropology of law. One night, I was sitting in the house of a friend in Doro Natika, the village where I was conducting fieldwork. One of my friend's relatives burst into the room, shouting that his sister-in-law, a woman named Inamona, had been assaulted by a young man, Laninda. We rushed over to Inamone's house to see what had happened. Inamone sat on the floor of the room, one side of her face painted with a medicinal paste, where she said Laninda had struck her. She also showed us the shirt she had been wearing and that had been torn in the assault. Her male relatives were angry and talked of taking down the spears and sharpening the bush knives, anxious to exact an immediate revenge on Laninda. But everyone became calmer when Amatifa, one of the principal elders of the village, came by to assure us that he and the other elders of Doronatika would convene a court and exact justice according to tradition. The next morning, they did just that. Laninda was brought before a group of elders with most of the village looking on. Inamona showed her medicated face and torn shirt as evidence. Laninda admitted to having shouted at her, but denied having laid hands upon her. A spirited and tumultuous drama ensued as members of the court, led by Amapansi, berated Laninda and finally extracted a confession. He was assessed a minor fine and was made to kneel before Inamone, begging forgiveness. She gave him a symbolic slap on the head, and he was let go. Later that afternoon, I chatted with a friend. I said, "Wasn't that terrible, what Laninda did, assaulting Inamone like that?" He answered, "Yes, it was, but you know he never really hit her." I was surprised. "What about the torn shirt and her face?" I asked. "Well," he said, "anyone can tear a shirt, and who knows what's under the medicine." I was deeply shocked. "But that means Laninda is innocent. Isn't this terribly unfair?" "Not at all," he replied. "What Laninda was convicted of was more true than what really happened." He then proceeded to fill me in on what everyone else in the village knew, indeed, what they had known all along. Inamone had seen Laninda hanging around Lafia, a young woman who was betrothed to another young man, absent from Doronatika. Inamone had complained to Laninda's mother, who in turn had admonished Laninda. Furious at having been ratted out, Laninda had gone to Inamone's house and threatened her, a serious breach of etiquette, but had not, in fact, assaulted her. This story is an account of a real event in the real world, as witnessed by an ethnographer. How would this event have been recorded and analyzed by a historian or a sociologist? To begin with, to a historian who works primarily with archives or court records, the case of Laninda's assault on Inamone would be completely invisible. The Dao Dongo do not keep written records of disputes settled by village elders, so this case and the great majority of cases would not appear in a form accessible to the historian working in an archive. Even a historian who adopts the ethnographic methods of an anthropologist and takes down oral histories might have difficulty in accessing this case, for among the Dao Dongo it is an accepted practice that one never discusses a dispute after it has been settled. Only because he was on the scene at the time the dispute erupted was Peter able to record it and explore its meaning. How would this case have appeared to a sociologist or a criminologist? Although some sociologists and criminologists are adept at using ethnographic methods, it is far more common for them to rely on surveys, questionnaires, and the analysis of official statistics. Again, to those relying on official statistics, this case would have been completely invisible. Laninda's assault might have appeared as a data point in a survey of disputes in the community undertaken by a sociologist, but it seems unlikely that a survey would be so artfully constructed as to see beyond the superficial evidence of the case, or, more importantly, to uncover the notion that Laninda's conviction of a crime he did not commit was more true than what really happened. If the case had been recorded officially, researchers, including anthropologists, who rely on such data, would probably assume the case of Laninda was one of simple assault, leading to conclusions about Dao Dongo society that would be seriously incomplete, if not misleading. Very well, then. What might the case described mean to an ethnographer? How might an anthropologist analyze this event to learn more about what the Dao Dongo believe and how they behave? First, after considerable questioning, it became clear to Peter that the case had little to do with assault and a very great deal to do with respect for the institution of marriage. Why had Inomone complained to Laninda's mother about his flirtations with La Fia? Because Inomone had a real and vested interest in protecting the integrity of betrothals, particularly betrothals contracted by the family of Amapansi. Why? Because Inomone's daughter was betrothed to Amapansi's son, and another of Amapansi's sons was betrothed to La Fia. One lesson, then, that Peter learned was that in disputes, at least among the Dao Dongo, things are often other than what they appear to be. A case of assault may really be a case about alienation of affection. What made this sort of realization possible? First of all, Peter was there to witness the event to begin with, something that would not have been possible had he not spent almost 2 years in this village. The ability to observe unusual, unique events is one of the principal advantages of the ethnographic method. It is important to recognize as well that Peter was able to observe the case in question from the outset, not only because he lived in Doro Natika for a long time, but because he lived there around the clock and as a member of the community.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.